Friends, welcome to the 106th session of Legal Empowerment Through Interaction lecture series. We have been exposed to different topics, different ideas, different thoughts, and the journey continues. Today we have a wonderful speaker, Dr. Kausar Edappagad, who is the district and sessions judge, Ernakulam. And the only disqualifications he may have is he was and is my classmate. Introduce the subject today, we have Justice A.M. Babu sir, who is the Director Academics of the Kerala Judicial Academy and the former judge of the High Court of Kerala. And indeed, we are privileged to have Justice Ramkumar sir also today with us and all of you wonderful participants who have been there with us. Today, we have a relook at something we had touched upon earlier, but still doubts linger. Now, today, we hope and expect that all our doubts will be cleared by Dr. Kausar Edappagad. And to introduce the subject, may I request Justice Babu.
Good evening and happy Independence Day.
Good evening.
So today's topic, I think it is very apt for the reason that many of us are lacking in knowledge, particularly on Muslim inheritance. Muslim inheritance is not an easy game. It's a very tough game. May not be possible to be, you cannot have something in your mind because depending upon the circumstances, the inheritance changes. So in, there was a Malayalam play called Adinimappuram, means beyond that. So that was by G. Shankarapillai. So that play, when that drama was played, there would be an announcement that they to the audience that the persons who come from the, your right hand side to the stage are the real characters, and the persons who come from your left hand side are imaginary characters. So you are confused when you look at, when you watch the play. A character, Damodaran, he comes from the right side. After some time, he comes from the left side. So both happen. So you are not in a position to understand he is a real character or he is an imaginary character in the play. Same is the, almost more or less same is the case with Muslim inheritance. A person who is a sharer, he may become a residuary. So if a father is a sharer, he may become a residuary. A daughter is a sharer, she may become a residuary, and therefore the characters often change. So far as the other area is concerned, I don't think it is very much tough. And that is one of the reasons I said that I will go for the divorce and marriage of Muslim law, because that is the, whenever I have an option, I will choose the easy one. So Dr. Kausar, is well read in all branches of law, particularly in Muslim law. And I think he will, I'm sure that he will do justice to all the participants here, all the viewers here, all the listeners here. So so far as Muslim inheritance is concerned, I have already said, then of course, testamentary, they are not very much tough because there are two and three general basic rules that Sri Kausar will come to that and give, and different kinds of hibas also, gifts also. Dr. Kausar will be dealing with hibas, then osiyat, that's will, and also the inheritance. So I don't think that I need to say anything more with this brief introduction. May I request Mr. Sampathman to invite Dr. Kausar to begin with the much awaited program. Thank you.
The interest in the subject is revealed, Babu sir, by the fact that we have 132 participants even the beginning now itself. So I'm sure that all of us would be benefited and empowered by the end of the session. Thank you for that brief introduction. Over to you, Kausar. Thank you very much.
Very good afternoon, all of you.
Good afternoon.
Thank you very much, Justice A.M. Babu sir, for your introductory remarks on the subject. And thank you very much, Sampathman, for inviting me and giving me an opportunity to become part of this web series season 2. In this strange timings of pandemic period where all activities have been reduced to a virtual standstill, organizing and successfully implementing a law lecture series continuously for 100 days without any break, utilizing the online platform, that way involving eminent legal personalities of various parts of the country on variety of topics, is something great, innovative, and deserves to be appreciated. I believe that this may be first of its kind in the country. At the outset, I would like to congratulate Shyam and his team for this great initiative and wish all the success in future endeavors. Secularism is a concept enshrined in the preamble of our constitution. It is considered as one of the philosophical foundations of the Indian polity. Still, various personal laws administered in our country is not secular in nature. Applicability of personal law depends solely on religion. Each community is governed by distinct personal law. Nowhere the term personal law has been defined. Personal law can be described as laws and customs as to family relations, family property and succession. Of course, wakaf and religious endowments are part of it. During British regime, all religious communities, including Muslims, were allowed to follow their personal laws. And permission to follow personal laws assumed statutory recognition in Government of India 1950. Section 112 of the repealed Government of India Act 1915 enjoined the High Courts of Calcutta, Madras, and Bombay to decide certain matters of their original jurisdiction according to such personal law or custom having the force of law. A similar provision has been incorporated in Government of India Act 1935 as well, Section 392. And under our Constitution, Article 225, the law administered by in any existing High Court is continued as before the commencement of the Constitution. In 1937, the British Imperial Legislature assured the Muslim personal law to Muslims by enacting the Muslim Personal Law Shariat Application Act. The Constitution itself has recognized the existence of various personal laws in operation in our country when Constitution was being adopted and enacted. Such recognition is apparent from Article 372(1), Entry 5 of List 3 of Sun Schedule, Article 246(2), Article 44, and Article 25. Under Article 371, all laws in force in the territory of India immediately before the commencement of the Constitution shall continue in force until altered, repealed, or amended by competent legislature or authority. We know that as per Article 13(1), all laws in force in the country, in the territory of India, immediately before the commencement of the Constitution, insofar as they are inconsistent with Part 3, shall to the extent of such inconsistency be void. So whether personal laws applicable to Hindus or Muslims or Christians or Parsis are laws in force within the meaning of Article 13(1) is a controversial and unresolved issue. And Entry 5, List 3 of 7th Schedule of the Constitution recognizes the existence of numerous personal laws and numerous existing personal laws. Muslim personal law is one of the existing personal laws in the country. The set entry read with Article 246(2) empowers the Parliament and the state legislature to legislate on all matters in respect of which parties and judicial proceedings were immediately before the commencement of the Constitution subject to their personal laws. Again, Article 44 mandates that state shall endeavor to secure for citizen a uniform civil code throughout the country. This article, by implication, recognizes the existence of different codes applicable to different communities. The very presence of Article 44 in the Constitution recognizes the existence of separate personal laws. Protection is extended to personal law through Article 25 of the Constitution as well. Personal law of every religious denomination is protected from invasion and breach except as provided by Article 25. Article 25 also recognizes the supremacy and enforceability of personal law of religion. Thus, the personal laws of various religious denominations in the country are recognized, administered, and enforced with the backing of the Constitution and other statutes. So far as the personal laws of the Hindus, Christians, and Parsis, other than the Muslims are concerned, all their personal laws are codified. Hindus, Buddhists, Jains, Sikhs, etc. are governed by Hindu Succession Act 1955 and Hindu Marriage Act 1955 and Hindu Succession Act 1956. Christians are governed by the Christian Marriage Act and Indian Divorce Act. Parsis are governed by the Parsi Marriage Act and Divorce Act. But so far as the Muslims are concerned, they are predominantly governed by the uncodified Muslim personal law. Section 2 of the 1937 Shariat application only says that in questions regarding marriage, divorce, interstate succession, gift, etc., in case where the parties are Muslims, the Muslim personal law shall apply. The major portion of the Muslim personal law is uncodified. Of course, there are a few codified statutes, or we know 1939 Act, which gives the power of right of judicial, divorce to the Muslim woman, and 1986 Act, which was enacted after Shabanu verdict, which gives compensation to the divorced Muslim woman. Apart from these two statutes, all other laws, including the law related to marriage, divorce, interstate succession, gifts, etc., are uncodified. The law is never static. It is always dynamic. Law does not stand still. It always moves continually. Law is a product of social evolution, and it must change with time and circumstances. But it is often said, or rather criticized, that the Muslim personal law, especially the law on divorce, polygamy, and interstate succession, as administered in our country, is ever static, never dynamic, and not in accordance with the principles of gender justice and the changing needs of the time, and violates the equality clause enshrined in the Constitution of India. It is generally believed that Muslim personal law is patriarchally harsh towards women and denied them sexual and economic freedom. The major criticism is leveled against the law relating to talaq, polygamy, and interstate succession. We know that in the Muslim law, which was hitherto administered in India, a Muslim husband is given unbridled power to divorce his wife. Of course, recently the Supreme Court Constitutional Bench in Shaira Banu's case in 2017 declared that the talaq bidat, that a triple talaq, is unconstitutional. And as per the present uncodified Muslim law, personal law administered in India, a Muslim male is free to have as many as 4 wives, of course, which subject to certain conditions, but a similar power is not there for Muslim wives. Male has such power. And so far as interstate succession is concerned, male get double share of that of female. Predecessor's son is excluded from inheritance if child is alive, and the widow gets very negligible share of 1/4 or 1/8, unlike other personal laws. So this criticism that there is gender discrimination in these areas may be partially true in the modern age. But at the same time, one cannot deny the fact that it was the Muslim law which recognized various audio, human rights.
Audio problem.
Sir?
There was an audio problem. Now I think it's getting better.
Wi-Fi.
Now it's okay?
Connectivity problem. Or is it my problem?
Sir, Kelkamba. I think Dr. Kausas is okay, sir. Can you just check yours also?
Am I audible?
Illa, kuzhappilla. You can continue. No issues.
I'll continue. So, even though the criticism levels against certain areas of Muslim law, that is law relating to talaq, polygamy, industry, etc., may be partially true in the modern age, one cannot deny the fact that it was the Muslim law which recognized various human rights in so many areas for the first time. The contractual marriage was provided as per Muslim law. Marriage is both a civil contract and religious right. So contractual marriage was provided, in fact, for a better scope for defining women's rights. And bride price that's prevailing in the tribal Arabia was converted to mahar. Mahar is something which husband gives to wife at the time of the marriage. It is commonly said as consideration. It is a novel feature of Muslim personal law. In fact, it is aimed at empowerment of the woman. It's not simply money or property promised by the Muslim husband to the wife as a consideration of marriage. It is basically a solemn gift from the husband as a token of respect, symbolizing the sincerity and love for her. And indissolubility of the marriage, which was prevailing among Hindus and Christians, was diluted and the divorce was granted to the Muslim woman. And divorce by mutual consent, based on breakdown theory, now which is accepted by almost all countries of the world now, was there in the Muslim law 1400 years back, the principles called Mubarak. You can just enter into an agreement if you feel that your marriage is irretrievably broken and end up the marriage. And Islam is the first legal system to grant woman's right of inheritance. Till the codification of 1955 Hindu Succession Act, Hindu law, 1956 Hindu Succession Act, women did not enjoy equal rights along with Hindu women. And of course, we know that even thereafter, the compulsory property as per Section 6, the male alone gets share by birth. Of course, in 2005 amendment, that has been taken away. And in an era of unlimited polygamy, it was limited to 4. So however, it is a fact that more than 1,400 years have been elapsed since these laws came into force. And since then, women have surged forward and occupied equal status with men. And in this modern age, how far these laws would withstand the scrutiny of the concept of gender justice and equality clause enshrined in the Constitution is a matter for open debate. So there is a cry for need for a uniform civil code from various concerns corners, including various judicial pronouncements by the apex court, or at least for the codification of Muslim law. The demand for latter, that is for the codification of Muslim law, is emerging predominantly from the community itself. With this preliminary observation on the topic, let me move on to my specific topic. That is property rights. Friends, in fact, I have prepared a PowerPoint presentation.
You can just mail it, I can play it from here. We can just
sure,
mail
sure. it. Sure. But I experienced some problem with my laptop, so I'm now presenting through my phone. So I'll be sharing with the slideshow. I'll be sharing with Mr. Shambhatman. So topics today I'm going to cover is property rights. So dispossession of property involves gratuitous and non-gratuitous transfer. non-gratuitous transfer, you all know, like sale, mortgage, lease, etc. And gratuitous transfer, gift. And of course, another branch of Muslim law, preemption. I'll cover gift and preemption, and of course, succession, both testamentary and intestate, that is will and inheritance. So these are the four main areas I'm going to cover: gift, preemption, will, and inheritance. Property is called as mal in the Muslim law. The property is a term having very wide connotation in the Muslim law. It's not mere title or ownership, but it covers possession, custody, mobile property, immobile property, corporeal, incorporate, use for its fruits, produce, dwelling rights, whether tangible or intangible, everything. And even right to recover debt and wife's claim to mahar also is regarded as the property for the purpose of disposition. When the wife's claim for dower from the husband, mahar can be deferred as well. So wife right to claim mahar also is transferable under the Muslim. I've already said that personal law is religion based, and what applies to Muslim law is 1937 Act, and Section 2 of the 1937 Act only says that in all questions regarding intestate succession, property of females, marriage, dissolution, dower, guardianship, gifts, etc., the rule of decision in cases where the parties are Muslims shall be the Muslim personal law. So all forms of disposition of property are not regulated by Muslim law. We have in India a secular law such as Contract Act, Sale of Goods Act, Partnership Act, and NA Act. All of these deal with properties. All these laws are applicable to Muslims, say, secular law. And Transfer of Property Act, which deals with the transfer of property, except Chapter 2 and 7. All the chapters are applicable to Muslims. And Chapter 2, Section 2D only says that nothing in the said chapter, that Chapter 2 from Section 5 to 53A, part performance, still part performance. Section 2D only says that nothing in this second chapter of this Act shall be deemed to affect any rule of Muhammadan law. Shall be deemed to affect any rule of Muhammadan law. That is what stated. It doesn't say that Section 2 does not apply to Muslim transfers. Well, what is stated is shall not affect any rule of Muslim personal law. So whenever the provisions of Chapter 2 and those of the Muslim law conflicts, the latter shall prevail, that's all. If there is no inconsistency with the Muslim law, with that of any of the provisions in the Chapter 2 from Section 5 to 53A, then these provisions in the Chapter 2 will apply propri rei vigor. That is the law. And in some old cases, it had been held that Section 14, 18, 21, 51, and 53 did not conflict with Muslim law, hence the TP Act would apply. Similar is the provision in Section 129. Section 129 of the TP Act also, there also it is stated that nothing in the said provision shall affect any rules of Muslim personal law. And but gift of actionable claim is regulated by Chapter 8 of the TP Act. So there also the Muslim personal law will not apply. So Section Chapter 2 of the TP Act and Chapter 7 of the TP Act, if those provisions conflict with Muslim law will prevail. That is the law. Then I'll come to gift. We all know that what is gift. Gift is a gratuitous transfer by one person to another, by one person called donor or donee, without consideration. And the substantive law which deals with the gift is section 123 to 129 of the TPA. As 121 to 122. As per section 123, section 123 of the TP Act says how a gift is to be effected. Attestation is necessary. Registration is necessary. Of course, it's if it is above 100 rupees. So a gift can be only made through a registered document attested by two attesting witnesses, subject to the proof by section 68 of the Evidence Act. But so far as the Muslim personal law is concerned, oral gift is valid. No registration is necessary. No attestation is necessary. A Muslim gift may be valid even without a registered document and may be invalid even with a registered document. Because even a Muslim executes a registered document of gift, unless three conditions are satisfied, it would be invalid. So the registration is not necessary, writing is not necessary, attestation is not necessary. What is necessary is declaration, acceptance, and delivery of possession. These are the three conditions which are necessary to constitute a Muslim gift. Declaration by the donor, acceptance by the donee, and the delivery of possession from the donor to the donee. Still, there is no taboo in Muslim law reducing the gift to writing to get it attested or registered. Interesting question arose in so many cases that Section 17(1) of the Registration Act deals with what are the documents to be registered. It includes subclause A, includes gift deed. And Section 49 says of the Registration Act deals with the effect of non-registration, which says that any document which is required by law to be registered under Section 71, if not registered, shall not affect any immoral property and is inadmissible in courts. So the question arose in so many cases before the High Court of Kerala as well as the Supreme Court. What is the legal status of a Muslim gift which is not reduced into writing, of if it is reduced into writing, not registered or attested, in view of Section 17(1) and 49? There is a very interesting decision by Justice V.R. Krishnayar in 1971 KLT 684. Not right, the young lawyers. I'll be sharing my PowerPoint presentation. It contains every rulings. Asan Rauter versus Amma Uma, 1971 KLT 684. It's very good decision. Young lawyers, please read it. Which differentiated the secular gift into non-secular gift. And Justice V.R. Krishnayar came with an innovative proposition that the exemption to Muslim gift from the purview of Section 123 as per Section 129 applies to only secular gifts and not to non-secular gifts. Justice observed in that said judgment that a gift by a Muslim paramour to a Muslim mistress cannot claim immunity from Section 123 on godly grounds. See, I've already said that Section 129 only says that the provisions of Section 123 shall not affect the Muslim law, rules of Muslim law. It does not say that it shall not apply to the Muslim law. So, Justice V.R. Krishnayar is of the view that every gift executed as per Section 123 of the TP Act has to be attested by two witnesses and to be registered in terms of Section 17 registration. Then unless and until, this is the word used, unless there is allergy to attestation in Muslim way of life or Islamic repugnance to registration made out, you can't say that Muslim gift is absolved from the provisions of the Registration Act and rigor of Section 68 of the Evidence Act and registration and execution attestation contemplated in Section 123. There, the justice differentiated between secular and non-secular gift and held that so far as the non-secular, secular gifts are concerned, like sadaqa, trust, waqf, etc., their oral gift is valid. In that decision, Justice V.R. Krishnayar has also considered the question whether the Muslim personal law is law in force under Article 13.1 and distinguishing the celebrated decision of Justice Chakla in Narasu Appamali's case, which held that laws in force is not law under Article 13.1 of the Constitution, hence not amenable to the Constitution. Distinguished that fact and held that personal law is laws in force and subject to Article 13.1, and held that Muslim law gives secular non-secular gift is violative of Article 14 and 15 of the Constitution. This was doubted. This decision was doubted. The Andhra Pradesh full bench in AR 1962 AP 1999. And ultimately, the Supreme Court of India in AR 2011 Supreme Court 1965, without referring to Justice V.R. Krishnayar's decision, held that all gifts, secular as well as non-secular gifts, need not be in writing, need not be attested, need not be registered. And there was yet another view in Justice V.R. Krishnayar's decision and as well as in so many other decisions of the High Court that suppose a Muslim reduced the gift into writing, whether it requires registration or not. The question was answered in this fashion that if the instrument of gift was intended to constitute the gift for the first time, it has to be registered. But if it was merely to serve as a record of a past event of gift, it need not be registered. That was the law prevailing till then. But the Supreme Court in 2011 SC 1965 held that it is not the requirement that in all cases where gift deed is contemporaneous to making of the gift, then such deed must be registered under Section 17 of the Registration Act. The Supreme Court finally settled the issue that so far as Muslims are concerned, whether it is oral, written, registered, unregistered, contemporaneous or recording a past event, what is to be proved is whether there is declaration, delivery of possession, acceptance, then it is a valid decision. That is the end of the matter. Or 2011 Supreme Court 1965. And the conditions to make gift hiba, like sanity and majority, and to whom gift can be executed, and who are the persons, what is the capacity to receive hiba. So it is permissible to natural persons. It is permissible to gift can be executed in favor of natural persons, artificial persons, non-Muslims, would-be heirs, or minors, mentally handicapped woman, everything. But a gift cannot be made to an unborn person, but life interest can be given to an unborn person as per the Muslim. And what is the subject matter of hiba? What is the subject matter of gift? All property can be gifted. And there is no restriction as to the quantum like will. There is a misconception. When we were practicing the common doubt that was being asked is whether any restriction like will, one third, etc., etc. There is absolutely no restriction. The whole property can be gifted. And corporeal or incorporeal property, debts, property under mortgage, property even in adverse possession, equity of redemption, undivided share, of course, subject to Musha, the principal come later on. Everything can be. And no presumptive heir cannot object, unlike in the will. Will, I'll come to presumptive heir as a right of objection in the will. But in so far as gift is concerned, no presumptive heir can object. Titles certain decisions of more than 8 decisions. And one decision, Privy Council decision, which deals with the distinctive features of Hibba. I have not read it. You can take it later on. The principles of Musha. It's a branch of Hibba. This is gift of undivided property. It's a gift of undivided property. The term Musha literally means confusion. This is with regard to the probable confusion regarding the enjoyment of the property by other co-sharers as a result of the gift by one sharer to the other co-sharer. The principles of Musha arises when transfer of a property is effected, transfer of an item of property effected, which is part of a larger or undivided property. This principle imposes a partial restriction. So if you make a gift of a portion of a property, if one of the co-owners make a gift of a portion of a property or is undivided share, which is divisible in character, that gift will not take effect. It is not void, but it is irregular, facit. So if such a gift is made, that could be rectified, that like partition of the property. Once after the gift, if the partition is made and share is separated, it is valid. Otherwise, it is invalid. But the whole property is indivisible. And one of the sharers gives a portion of his undivided share, but property is indivisible. Or if by such gift, the property could be enjoyed for better advantage, then this principle does not apply. So also, if the gift of the undivided share cannot affect the normal enjoyment of the property, or if the physical partition is made that may determinately affect the enjoyment of the property, a gift shall not fail by reason of this Musha. So Musha is, the principle is very simple. If a co-sharer transfer a negligible share of his property to a stranger, then if by that transfer it would affect the enjoyment of the property by the other co-sharers and division is impossible, then that gift will fail. If it is divisible, that can be rectified by subsequent partition of property. And scope and ambit of Musha has been explained in 1977 KLT 193. I'll give you the and 70 KLT 23 has observed that Musha rule is archaic and not consistent with the modern notion of right to property. Now I'll come to another important branch, that is preemption. You know what is preemption? I think all of you might know. The preemption is a legal right, a legal privilege to acquire some immoral property in priority to the other prospective purchasers. Suppose I transfer my right over a conship property to a third party. Or suppose I transfer a property in which Shyam Padman is having easement rights. Or suppose I and Shyam Padman are neighbors and I sell a property, sell my property to a third party. In these three cases, my co-owner or Shyam Bathman, who is having easement right over my property, or Shyam Bathman, who is neighbor, who will be in a better position if the property is sold to him, can exercise this right of preemption, that is the law preemption. There are certain conditions. The preemption, this concept was first introduced in India by the Muslims, by the Muslim law. It was introduced during Mughal period. But Section 2 of 1937 Act does not recognize preemption. So, preemption is recognized by the court based on customary law, justice, equity, and good conscience. There are certain various state acts which recognizes and permits preemption. In Punjab, there is Punjab Preemption Act 1913. In Agra, Delhi, there is Agra Preemption Act. In Rajasthan, there is Rajasthan Preemption Act. And Section 22 of the Hindu Succession Act, in a lighter version, preemption is permitted. There are three types of preemption. One, Jivar, that is neighborhood vicinage, ownership of the adjoining immovable property. Like I already said, if I sell my property to a third party, my neighbor can exercise the right of preemption. This is there in Christian Muslim law, Jivar. Second, kilt, that is participation in appendages or amenities or easements. If Mr. Shyam Bathman is having easement right over my property, if I sell the dominant heritage to a third party, he can say that I need that property because I'll be in a better position if that property is allotted to me. And the third one, sharik, that is co-ownership. It's very common. If myself, Shyam Bathman and Ram Kumar Sir are co-owners of the property, if I sell a property to a stranger, either of them can claim that property. Of course, they have to offer the more concession that offered by a stranger to me. These are the three different types of preemption that was there in the pristine Muslim law. But
is that right available even if he is a non-Muslim? Is that right available even to a non-Muslim?
Yes. Among these three, the first two was declared by unconstitutional Supreme Court in two decisions, 1962 Supreme Court 1476 and 1965 Supreme Court 314. First two ground, AR 1962 Supreme Court 1476, AR 1965 Supreme Court 314, on the premises that it offends Article 91F, which was then prevailing, right to property. Right to property. But so far as the third ground is concerned, it was permitted. And answer to you, sir's question, there's a direct decision on that point, 1954 Supreme Court 417, which says that if custom is set up and proved, it applies to non-Muslims as well. It was introduced by Muslims, but if custom is set up and proved, it applies to non-Muslims as well. And there is a Madras decision and a Bombay decision which says that in erstwhile Madras presidency, preemption is not recognized among Muslims also because there is no custom in Bombay too. Section 2 of the Sharia Act does not specifically recognize preemption. Then it can be administered to the Muslim law, divorced to the Section 2, then the custom and usage has to be proved. See, in erstwhile Madras, including Kerala, and in Bombay, there is no custom, so there are two decisions which say that it doesn't apply. But Kerala decisions are right applies to Kerala. One decision of Madras presidency says that. The Supreme Court made it clear that if there is custom, it applies to Muslims as well as non-Muslims. Yes.
There are three steps.
In such cases, how a third party may be knowing that you are going to, because in the case of a partition or co-ownership, they can make a request, because even in the clause, in the partition itself, we can make a preemptory clause. But as far as third parties are concerned, how can they know that such a transaction is going to happen?
See, first of all, the right.
Even you know, suppose even if assuming that that has been already taken place, whether see, the third party can exercise that right.
Even the transaction can be set aside, did not?
Yes, right of preemption can be exercised only after the sale, not before that. The cause of action arises only after the sale takes place. Before that, you can't inject. You can't inject that I'm going to. So once the transaction is effected, any party aggrieved feels that the property has to be, he makes a claim over that property, he has to institute a suit. There are three conditions. Immediately after knowing that such a sale has taken place, he has to make a declaration first that I am going to exercise this option. Declaration, he has to declare. Then that declaration has to be affirmed in the presence of two witnesses. Then that, if the declaration or affirmation is not conceded, then it has to be instituted for enforcement. The limitation period is 1 year. 2001-3 KLT short not 8. That is the law. But under section 22 of the Hindu Succession Act, where but there is a difference under section 22 of the Hindu Succession Act, which deals with preferential right to acquire property in certain cases, which says that where after the commencement of this act, interest in any more property of an intestate or in any business carried on by him or her, whether solely or in conjunction with others, devolve upon two or more heirs specified in class 1 of the schedule, and any one of such heirs proposes to transfer his or his interest in the property or business, the other heir shall have a preferential right to acquire the interest proposed to be transferred. That is regarding preferential right. There the statute itself says that proposes to transfer. So there are decisions which says that even before the actual transfer takes place, you can exercise, you can invoke section 22. But whereas the preemption that is available to Muslims under the Christian Sharia law, that could be exercised only after the actual transaction takes place. Then there is a direct decision on this 2008 4KLT 265 Supreme Court. Sale should be complete. Sale alone give rise to preemption. No cause of action arises when there is only an agreement for sale. Direct decision on the point. Sale alone give rise to preemption. And this preemption applies to only to sale alone. Gift, will, inheritance, lease, mortgage, etc. do not attract. Even inheritance do not attract, only sale. And there are decisions which says that the preemptor as well as the seller must be Muslims to apply on the basis of the customary law of Muslim law. Of course, if there is a custom on some part, that preemption applies to all religious communities, of course, it is permissible.
Yes.
And there is, to young lawyers, please note this judgment. Matao Devi was a Damodar Lad, 2001-6 SCC 330. 2001-6 SCC 330. Here, the substantive and procedure principles of Muslim law and the right of preemption is very well explained. Please read it, you will get a entire idea of the principles of preemption. And the Supreme Court in IR 1960 SC 136 says that a right of preemption is a very weak right. And Section 22, I have already in between I mentioned that Section 22, as per Section 22, preferential right is there to class 1 heir. Statutory recognized principal preemption. Decisions as skipping. Then I'll come to succession, next branch. The succession includes testamentary and non-testamentary. I first deal with testamentary succession will. Wasiyat. The major legislative enactment of India relating to inheritance, wills, and administration of estate is the Indian succession, 1925. But the substantive of wills and inheritance apply to Muslims. Part 2 to 5, section 4, 21B, 23, 29, 58 specifically says that these are the provisions which deals with succession, probate, will, intestate succession, etc. Section 58 specifically deals with will, 58 onwards, will, which says, Section 50 specifically says that the chapter relating to will doesn't apply to Muslims. Then the question is whether 1937 Sharia Application Act applies to recognizes the will to Muslims. Section 2 does not. If you look at Section 2, it does not mention will at all. But there is a provision under Section 3. This area, I think many are ignorant. Because the application of Muslim law, application of the personal law to the Muslims gets its sanction from 1937. Section 2 specifically deals with marriage, divorce, intestate succession, waqf, guardianship, etc., etc., etc. But it does not specifically mention will or adoption. But it is mentioned in Section 3. Section 3 says a Muslim has to make a declaration in a prescribed format before the recognized prescribed authority that he desires to apply the provisions regarding wills and adoption in Muslim personal to him. Unless such declaration is made, this will not apply to him. The provisions of Muslim personal regarding will or adoption will not apply to him. But in fact, when 1937 bill was presented and discussed, Jinnah wanted Section 2 itself to be optional. Jinnah was of the view that the application of Muslim personal law to the Muslims should be made optional. But others did not agree. But as far as wills and adoptions are concerned, it was made optional. That is why Section 3 was incorporated. It was not there initially. Section 3 was not there initially in the bill. It was later on incorporated. And Section 3 says that to make a declaration, every state has to frame a rule. But most of the states in India, even though more than 80 years have been passed, not framed rule. We all know that Kerala passed rule 2 years before. So, in cases where rules are in states where rules are framed, and the Muslims who did not opt to be governed by Muslim personal law, so far as wills and adoptions are concerned, they are governed by customary law relating to adoption and wills, because 1925 Indian Succession Act will not apply, specifically excluded in Section 58. So those in Kerala hereafter, those who do not, I have not declared, I have not made a declaration so far. So far as I am concerned, if I have not made a declaration, the Muslim person regarding will and adoption will not apply to me, then what is the law which would apply? Succession Act cannot be applied. So customary law. Then what is customary law? The customs we follow, the Muslim person. So naturally, maybe it has not been decided in any case. But so far as adoption is concerned, so now it's different because the JJ Act has been amended recently and a secular law has been passed. So far as adoption is concerned, so adoption goes. So far as will is concerned, every Muslim where rules are framed has to make a declaration. And so far as Malabar Muslims are concerned, there is yet another act, the Mappala Wills Act. The Malabar Muslims who are governed by Marumakthan law, Mappala Wills Act of 1928, it specifically says that to Marumakthais of Muslims, Muslim personal law will apply. So even though section 2 of the 1937 does not specifically mention the will, so far as the Marumakthais of Malabar are concerned, the Muslim personal will apply in by virtue of the Mappala Wills Act. Maybe complicated to yes. Then like Hiba, the gift, the will also need not in writing. Oral will is permissible. And if written, need not be attested. Section 68 would not apply. If written, need not be attested. If attested, need not be registered. Another important feature of the law of wills. Then another important feature of Muslim law, that there is a limit to the bequest. There are different schools of Muslim law. I didn't want to confuse more. That's why I didn't mention about the different schools. Sunni, Shia, Sunni further, Hanafi, Maliki, Nasir, etc.
Don't bring in Musha here also.
So I'm not confusing, but I'll just tell you that Sunni, Hanafis and Shafis, there is some differences in the inheritance as well as the limit that is prescribed for making wills, etc. But predominantly in India, we are all are Sunnis and we follow the Hanafi schools of Sunni law. So I have
there is a presumption, is it not? There is a presumption.
There are two decisions of the. There is a presumption that Muslims and Sunnis, Muslims in India are Sunnis, and they are following Hanafi school. That's with pro contra. And so I am mentioning Hanafi, Sunni Hanafi only. Otherwise, it will lead to another confusion. So the Muslim law does not permit the bequest in favor of heirs. So no will can be executed in favor of heirs. But Shyama, hello?
Yes. Kelkunnunde.
Yes. Kelkavalu Shyam. Kelkam. The break. Okay. So bequest to heirs is totally prohibited, but it is not void. If I execute a will in favor of my children or one of my children, it's not void altogether. If after the death, others consent, it becomes valid and enforceable. The consent has to be voidable at the option, of course. The consent has to be exercised only after the death, not before the death, because the will come into force only after the death. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. But to the non-heirs, bequest is permissible up to the maximum 1/3. of the estate of the testator. One third is permissible. That is called the bequeathable third. And if you make bequest of more than one third, the same rules will apply, that it's not void altogether, but after the death, if the other legal is consent, that will take effect. But suppose, so this is the rule, to the heirs, you cannot make any will at all unless the other heirs consent after the death, and to the non-heirs, you can make maximum one third. But the legator has left no heir at all, the rule of bequeathable third will not apply because there is no heir. You can bequest to the stage, the everything, the whole stage. And also it will not apply to a will made in favor of a sole heir, because there is no other heir to exercise the option. So in these two circumstances, this rule of bequeathable third will not apply. And in deciding whether a person or is not an heir, the crucial time is not the date of the execution of the will, but the time of the testator's death. This may happen when the sovereign Muslim or Muslim law is concerned, a predeceased son, when a son is alive, is not an heir. So, a bequest made in favor of a predeceased son is valid to the extent of one third, if not a heir. So, the question will naturally arise, when is the exact date? So, in deciding whether the person is or not an heir, the crucial time is not the date of execution of bill, but the time of testator's death. This is 1982 KLT 643. What are the principles in Muslim law in this restriction of bequeathable third? To keep the legator's heirs away from mutual discords and jealous after his death. That is the first justification of it. And practice of favoritism and prejudices in favor of some heirs. And most importantly, the belief of Islam is that God has made everything, that God has made the law of inheritance, how it will take into effect after one's death. That cannot be disturbed by the man on earth. That is the principle. To prevent from altering the division of estate between heirs as prescribed under the law, the gods of inheritance. But this does not appear to be sound in the modern world. And by this principle, in fact, right to dispose of his properties in any way he likes is interfered with. And most importantly, this in the law of inheritance, I already mentioned that deceased son is excluded if son is alive. And if the children are alive, widow gets only one each share. And they are heirs. Even a will cannot be made in their favor because of this restriction. Otherwise, at least will could have been made to get over that lacuna, that discrepancy in the law of inheritance. And under the Muslim law, any property can form the subject matter of the will. Corpus, usufructs, even life interests can be such. And a corpus need not necessarily be in existence when the will is made. It must be, the rule is that it must be in existence when the will comes into operative at the time of the legator's death. There are a few decisions which says there cannot be any presumption of consent by passive accusants with knowledge of disposition. There should be positive consent has to be confirmed. Mere accusance is not sufficient. 2007, 2 KLT short note 50. But there is another decision that consent can be gathered from long course of conduct. Express consent did not mean necessary. 93.2 KLT, 1025. And a Muslim cannot execute several wills in favor of different heirs or strangers so as to limit the bequest under each will to less than 1/3, thus overcome the maximum, circumvent the bar. And the requirement is that there is the bar is for the total bequest. You can make so many wills, but maximum 1/3. That is decided in 2011, 2 KLT 200. And section 68 of the Evidence Act does not apply to the will, Muslim will, even if it is reduced to writing. That is 1988, 2 KLT 643. Section 68 of the Evidence Act does not apply to a Mohammedan will. A Mohammedan will need not be in writing. It can be verbal also. Even if it is in writing, it does not require to be signed. Even if signed, it does not require attestation. But that does not mean that strict proof is not required in cases of dispute. We all know that the rigorous proof is necessary to prove the will. All suspicious circumstances surrounding the execution of the will has to be removed by the proponent, etc. All these principles are applicable to Muslims as well. Only thing that the rigor of Section 68 is not there, but the will has to be proved otherwise. There is no bar in proving the will through Section 68, 70, etc. if it is in writing, but can be proved otherwise also. And this rule of 1/3, that various reforms have been made in various Muslim countries, Sudan, Iraq, and Egypt. The bar to bequest to heirs has been taken away. So there, in those countries, Sudan, Iraq, and Egypt, 1/3 is permissible to heirs as well as to non-heirs. And revocation, as in the case of other personal law, that express and implied revocation by conduct or by execution of another will, etc., is permissible under Muslim law as well. Before coming to inheritance, I'll just deal with one more important feature, that is marjal mauth, that is deathbed transactions. Bonatio mortis causa. This, the gift made during death illness. We often see so many cases that the last days one is influenced by the relatives and either will or gift is executed. It's a common practice. But there is a beautiful law in Muslim law that if a gift or will is made in the deathbed, gift will takes the form of will only. That is 1/3 only. That to the strangers, not to the legalists. And there are certain conditions that are to be fulfilled, that proximate danger of death. There should be proximate danger of death. There should be apprehension that he may die. An external indication that he is suffering from such an illness. And he should eventually die of it. So what is the law with regard to any acknowledgement of debt that is executed in deathbed? The acknowledgement of debt, if it is in favor of an heir, not admissible as a proof of debt. But if it is in the case of in favor of a non-heir, the debt has to be otherwise proved, then the acknowledgement can be proved. That is the law. There is a decision on this 1955 KLT short note 23. Three conditions necessary for constituting death illness. Illness, 1. 2. Expectation of a fatal issue. 3. Settled physical incapacities which indicate the degree of illness. So the next I will come to
If he survives, then it is not valid.
It is not valid. So no doubt. Because takes in the form of a will. So will to come into operation, the death is necessary. Even if it is a gift, will be whatever. That is why one third will be
there. Not that if he survives, can it not be treated as a gift?
Even at the time of executing the gift, it has to be treated as a will. Is it not?
Yeah, but if it is in the bed, it will lapse. If he survives later on, it will lapse. The condition of it is health at the time of the execution matters, not whether subsequently survives or not is a different issue. That is my understanding, sir. Ramesh, sir. And I come to.
It is always confusing. That is a difficulty. Yeah,
it is better to be in the green bench, sir, not on this personal
matter.
So, even as a lawyer, we used to consult the Muslim lawyers whenever things comes. Vijay, what is prevailing law? How will it be treated?
Yeah.
We would get advice from them.
Yes, my senior Justice Mustaq's father, Mr. Mustafa.
He is an expert.
He was an expert. That's why I also got some interest in Muslim law from the very inception.
And I think that can, as far as
some problem.
Tarasiri is concerned, Usanguti or not Usanguti?
Yes.
Umar Kuti, or just like that. He is an expert on that. Because whenever the inheritance comes, calculation will be given to him. Or we will accept whatever the Muslim lawyers say.
I used to leave it to the lawyers on either side. Come to an agreement.
Okay. Then I'll come to inheritance, interesting assertion.
Yes.
Inheritance, as Justice Ramakrishna Sir said, the share calculation is the most difficult area. But to the young lawyers, I assure that by the end of this session, I'll assure that you'll be okay with that share calculation. I'll give you a tip. Yes, anyway. Inheritance, certain basic principles we have to understand, the Muslim law. It's a very important branch in Muslim law and different from so many other branches. So different from other parallel systems, other personal laws of India. Section 2 of the Shariat Act specifically recognizes Indian Succession Act and Mapa Succession Act, which applies to the Muslims. Marmakathais of North Malabar also specifically says that even to the Marmakathais, this Muslim inheritance would apply. In fact, that's the Muslim law does not permit this joint family system and Marmakathaim system at all, because the right by birth is alien to Muslim law. The basic principle of Muslim law is that you acquire your right over property only on the death, not by birth. Otherwise, it should be transferred in divorce or gift, etc. It is fundamental. The principles, joint family system and corpuscentry, Marmakathaim, etc., it's fundamentally against the Muslim.
Can you hear, Shyam?
Yes, sir. Any problem with this?
Sir, some break is there, it appears.
Now is, sir, can you hear me?
Yes, now we are.
Yes. Mapala Succession Act specifically says that the Marmakathai Muslims of North Malabar, this Muslim personal law would apply. So what I said is, in fact, the joint family system, corpuscentry, Marmakathai system of inheritance, etc., is totally alien to the Muslims, Shariats.
I think because one more act is there. Mapala Marmakathaim Act is also
Mapala Marmakathaim Act.
Succession Act and Mapala Marmakathaim Act is there. Madras Marmakathaim Act and Mapala Marmakathaim Act and Mapala Succession Act. It deals with the succession alone.
As far as the Malabar is concerned.
Yes. Then Muslim law does not, the pristine Muslim law as well as Muslim personal law does not recognize the right by birth at all. Then Marmakathaim system is just opposite that principle. Still, we are governed by, we Malabari Muslims are governed by Muslim personal law. That is the anomaly. Then inheritance arises on the death. So when a Muslim dies,
Lakshadweep, the Muslims are governed by Mirmukhtayim law.
Yes. Yes.
When a Muslim dies, there are four duties which need to be performed. These are: one, payment of funeral expenditure; two, payment of his or her debts; three, execution of his will; and four, distribution of remaining estate among the heirs according to Sharia. So payment of funeral expenditure, payment of debt, will we have dealt with, and the fourth one is distribution of shares according to Sharia. Before coming to the certain controversial areas, and before coming to the allocation and calculation of share, I'll first deal with certain general principles, certain unique features of Muslim personal law. The first one, there is no distinction between movables and immovables. There is no distinction between self-acquired property or ancestral property, unlike the Hindu law. Now that has been taken away, of course. And even the latest decision shows that it has got retrospective effect. So it's completely done away with the ancestral property section 6. And the third important thing is the rule of interstate succession are the same whether the interstate is male or female. See, interstate is male or female, the succession is same. But the person of inheritance is male or female, there is difference. And under the Hindu law, when the mother, the property of the mother divorces differently as that of the property of the father. Male and, I mean, section 6 and 8.
15.
Male and female. But Muslim law, whether it is the property of the male or female, there is no difference. And whatever be the nature of the acquisition of the properties also, there is no difference. If it is acquired from, I think, section 17 or of the Hindu succession act, if it is acquired from mother.
15 is female. 17 is in respect of joint family.
Yes, yes. Anyway, the succession differs according to acquisition of property. Here, yes, there is absolutely no such distinction in Muslim law. And right by birth and system of copaster is unknown to Mirmukhtayim law. There are three major criticism to the Muslim law of inheritance. I'll deal with it. One, predeceased son or daughter is totally excluded. Two, male gets double that of the female. Three, widow gets inadequate share, 1/4 or 1/8, as the case may be. I'll first deal with male gets double. Under Muslim law of inheritance, son gets twice share of a daughter, brother gets twice share of a sister, widower gets twice share of a widow, father in certain circumstances twice that of a mother. This is the most controversial issue. It is often criticized that this is sex-based discrimination. Here the crucial question that arises is whether, I'll just deal with that as well, whether this discrimination based on sex alone offends Article 14 and 15 of the Constitution of India. It was considered in so many cases. So one argument all along advanced is that Muslim personal law or any other personal law is not a law in force defined under Article 371 of the Constitution and thus is not a law under Section 13(1) and not amenable to Part 3 of the Constitution. This is the argument that has been all along advanced and found favor the celebrated decision in Narasu Appamali 1950 to Mumbai 84.
a very celebrated decision. That was followed by the Supreme Court in Krishna Singh's case in 1980 and Matthew versus Union of India case went from Kerala High Court in 1992 KLT 248. In all these decisions, it was held that personal laws are not laws in force and thus not a law under Article 13, then not amenable to the Constitution, Part 3 of the Constitution. Thus, even if it offends Article 14 or 15, it cannot be declared as unconstitutional. But later on, in two decisions, not expressly referring to Naraswapamari's case, Supreme Court, in 1996 and 1965, in Santharaman Masilamani Mudaliar's case, took the view that laws in force includes personal laws comes within the definition of laws in force and then amenable to Article 3, amenable to Part 3 of the Constitution. If it offends the Article 14 and 15 can be declared as unconstitutional. Apparently, this law that when a male dies, when father dies, son and daughter, son gets double, it violates Article 14, not out of it. But this law, but that is whether Muslim personal law is a laws in force, has not been settled at all. And recently, the Constitutional Bench of the Supreme Court, in Shaira Banu's case, which declared the triple talaq as unconstitutional, considered this issue. There also the question came, like this discrepancy in inheritance, the triple talaq also is a part of personal law. So it cannot be declared as unconstitutional since personal law is not a law in force. Such an argument was raised. But what is the finding? You all know that finding is that it violates Article 14 and 15 of the Constitution declared unconstitutional. But when you look at that decision, it's interesting. What was held by the Supreme Court in Shaira Banu's case is Muslim personal law is a state action, is a statutory law because 1937 Act recognizes the Muslim personal law. So it gets the color of a state action, a statutory law, and hence amenable to Constitution. That was the majority view. That was the view by Justice Nariman and Justice Lalit. The minority view of Justice Kahar and Justice Nasir was that it's not a state action, it's not amenable to Constitution. And when it comes to Justice Kurian Joseph agreed with the minority view that it's not a state action. But Justice Kurian Joseph found that in Shamim Aras case earlier, the Supreme Court has held that the triple talaq is not triple talaq is not sanctioned by Quran and hence applying the principle of Article 144 was struck down. So even though the triple talaq was declared as unconstitutional in Shaira Banu's case, does not declare the law whether the personal law is a law in force or does not declare by a majority that whether it's a state action or not. So still that controversy remains there. So if ultimately founds that personal law is either state action or personal law is the law in force, definitely this rule regarding double share would be declared as unconstitutional. Let's see the near future. And see, there is justification offered by Muslims. To a certain extent, it's a valid justification as well for this rule. See, in pre-Islamic period, women had no inheritance right at all. Like many other law of the religion, even Hindus or Christians earlier, there was no right to woman. Pre-Islamic rule, there was no inheritance at all. It was Islam for the first time gave inheritance right to the Hindu, female, at a reduced share.
So the proponents of Muslim persons, those who justify this double principle, double share rule, says this rule is based on family responsibilities. We know that Sharia is premised on a patriarchal family structure. In this family, father is the head. So it's not at all a sex-based discrimination, but it is based on family responsibilities and premised on a family. Sharia itself is premised on a patriarchal family structure. The justification is this. Say a woman in Islam receives assets from three sources. One, inheritance. Two, mahar. Mahar is a mandatory thing. She gets mahar. Three, she gets maintenance. It's the duty of the husband to maintain her. So she gets three assets. But male gets double on one source only, that is through inheritance. But he has more expenditure. He has to give mahar to wives, maintenance to wives, and other dependents. And a bridegroom is supposed to provide a bride with a marriage gift also. And neither the groom nor the bride's family have any share or control over the mahar or the gift. The bride is under no obligation to present any gift to her groom. And no matter how rich a wife is, she is not obliged to act as a co-provider for the family. No maintenance obligation at all. And gives the man a larger portion of the inherited property. So the justification offered is that the larger portion of the inherited property is given to man to meet his family needs and social responsibilities and obligations. This is the justification that is offered. How far that suits the present world is a different issue. Mm-hmm. And this double rule is there not only in Muslim personal law, it is there in Parsi law. Succession Act Part 5, Chapter 3. Double rule is there. And in Somalia and Turkey, this rule of double share of men has been changed. Now it is equal rights. That is about double share rule. And come to the next controversial, next criticism, that is predeceased son doesn't inherit. See, suppose A dies. A has two children, B and C. B dies before A's death. B left with two minor children. So at the time of A's death, A left with two minor children of his predeceased son and another surviving son. Mm-hmm. As per Muslim law, the entire property will go to the surviving son, leaving behind the predeceased children. Predeceased children will not get any right at all. That is the present Muslim verse. I think you have followed it. If there is anything more, I'll clarify in question and answer session. So that there is a total exclusion of predeceased child's child by the surviving child. It is a crying need for the reform. It cannot be justified at all by any justification. The
1 minute.
Just a moment, Allah. And the justification offered is that the Islam does not believe in the doctrine of representation. In other words, the nearer heir totally excludes a remoter heir. For example, if there are two heirs who claim inheritance from a common ancestor, the heir who is in nearer in degree to the deceased would exclude the heir who is remoter. And one cannot claim through a deceased person. See, you will inherit only from a deceased person. You cannot claim from another deceased person. That is the rule. And in some countries, Islamic countries, which says that you can make compulsory gift or will. In Egypt, in Algeria, in Algeria, even in Pakistan, Bangladesh, this rule has been completely taken away. Even the diseased children would get right out. In Egypt, Iraq, Jordan, Kuwait, Morocco, Syria, Tunisia, etc., their compulsory bequest within the limit of 1/3 has been made mandatory. But India still is there. And another area is widow's share. Widow gets only 1/4 if there are children. If no children, if there are children, 1/8. There also the justification is that widow gets dower, mahar, and she gets and she has no obligation to maintain her children, and she has in general fewer obligations. These are the justification. So these are the three main criticism that is leveled against how far this would stand the scrutiny of Article 14 and 15. I have already mentioned.
What it's about a, the maintenance of a widow? Maintenance of a widow. Who will maintain her?
Maintenance widow? Of
widow.
Widow. That is.
Widow prays with his son.
That depends up. That depends upon who service.
So,
maintenance is always to the male.
All right, but then her husband is no more.
Her husband's then, brother will come. Husband's okay. Brother. Suppose husband's brother is there, is not there. Husband's brother has sister has no obligation, but husband's male son, if earns, yes. And if nobody is there, it's best with the government and India. So as per that 1986 Act, talk of both. It's best with the government. In 1986 Act, there is a provision that even
instead of a sheet, it goes to a cuff.
Yes.
Instead of here a it sheet.
Is here it is, a sheet act is there, so it's wakaf board. So the maintenance always to male only. It depends upon who is the surviving persons. Then disqualifications of inheritance. Apostasy is disqualification is there, that is there in the prescription Hindu law as well. But after caste disabilities removal act, it is not there. And murderer will not, suppose son commits murder of father, he will not inherit. An illegitimate child inherit from the mother, not from the begetter. Next area is Shyam time.
You can cover that subject also, I believe. It's only 5:15. 15 more minutes.
Okay. Within 10 to 15 minutes, I'll finish.
Yes.
The next area is ascertainment and allocation of share. There also, there is a drastic difference between Hanafi and Shia law of inheritance. But we are governed by Hanafi law. I'll deal with Hanafi law only. See, there are three categories of heirs, like class 1, class 2, etc. in the Hindu law. There are three categories in Muslim law. One, Quranic heirs. It is called sharers. Second, procedures. Third, distant kindred. It's very simple. It's not as complicated as everyone thinks. And there is a simple method to calculate the share as well. Is it audible, Shyam?
Yes.
It is audible.
Yes. The sharers comes in the first category. Those who come with the sharers, come within the sharers, definite specified shares are allotted to them, like 1:2, 1:3, 2/3, if there are more than one, 1/6, 1/8, definite prescribed share is allotted. There are 12 categories of persons comes in the category of sharers, and out of which 9 are female. Their share is guaranteed. It is prescribed in the Quran itself. They are mother, spouse, husband or wife, mother's mother, father's mother,
daughter, son's daughter, and sisters, and sister, full half or uterine. It is there in all the textbooks of mother law. You need not by heart it. There's a table is provided. When you look at the sharer, shares, these persons will come. You just understand the principle. First of all, the principle that whenever there is male and female, in most cases, it is double. Predeceased son will not inherit. And widow, 1/4, 1/8. This is the basic principle. Then you first enter that, you ascertain who are the surviving persons of the deceased. And first ascertain whether any of them is included in the category of shares. Suppose mother is there. Mother will get a specified share. Husband is there. Husband also is. Mother's mother, no. Father's mother, no. Daughter is there. She will get. Son, she will get. Then, the second category comes. Residuary. Suppose there is no heirs at all. First, you look at whether any of the surviving persons comes within the 12 categories mentioned under the sharers. Suppose there is no sharers at all. The entire thing goes to the residuaries. Residuaries, no specific share is given. 1, 3, 1, 2. Residuaries, the entire residue will go to the residuary. There is also a class, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, etc. They consist of mainly male agnates and 4 specified female agnates, such as daughter, son's daughter, full sister, and consanguine sister. I don't mention it. Like Babu sir has said, sometimes sharers also will come in the residuary as well. So suppose if there is no sharers at all, everything goes to residuary. And suppose after distributing the shares to the sharers, if something is left, that left portion also will go to the procedure. Mostly, procedure and sharers, there will be legal heirs, which falls within the heirs and procedure. The third category is distant kind. Suppose there is no residuary, there is no sharers. So the property will go to the distant kindred only in a case where there is neither sharer nor residuaries. A distant kindred is not entitled to succeed if there is a sharer or distant kindred, sharer or residuary.
The column on now, Shia Madhuri just to I think all can see it. Yes. Shia, suppose you simply give or male dies.
Okay.
Wives, two wives. Give two wives.
One second. So I'll enter in the column wife two. Okay. No. Put two.
Two. Sons three.
Sons three. Okay, done.
Daughters four.
Daughters four. Fine.
Father one.
Should be one. Father one, then?
Mother one.
Mother one, okay.
Full sister one.
Full sister. What is half sister? Full sister.
Last.
Yeah. Okay, one second. Full sister one, okay.
Hello. Okay. Calculate share.
Calculate is there.
Where is it?
Reference calculate.
Calculate. Okay.
Just click.
Got it.
You got it?
Oh, very good.
That is magic,
relax.
No, that is where artificial intelligence works.
Yes. So,
Ramkumar sir, you see the magic of artificial intelligence.
Yes. Now Kausar can go home.
All will be able to calculate without any difficulty.
Purpose of avatar is finished.
No, secret has gone. Of calculating Muslim share has gone.
Yes.
In my slide, I have given three sides. Okay.
Okay.
And it is this CITES calculation based on ANAFI law that what we follow in India. Mm. So it's very safe. I use it regularly whenever.
Almost all known permutations and combinations are available here, right? Number of persons.
Everything. Everything. And I have cross checked it so many times. It's
wonderful. Yeah.
That's no, true. Not that. No, suppose the share is increased or residuary is available and such distributed arrows.
All those things will be worked out.
Everything will be worked out.
Ramushan sir, you need only enter the number of wives, husband, father, etc. Rest
will be taken care of.
Yes. Even everything is taken care of. No issues.
There will be no musha at all. Confusion.
Ultimate product will come.
No confusion.
So, Shyam, I'll conclude here. Then I'll...
This was the best part of your lecture.
the last one is the magical part. I mean, that was the icing or the best.
Half a cake.
Absolutely.
No, had it been at the beginning.
Then we could have just asked Kausar to go home.
Yes. Nobody will be interested in hearing it because everybody was thinking that it is very difficult to answer.
Yes, number of tweets have been.
You must be aware of the basic principles.
Yeah, yes. Absolutely. I mean, you did the right thing. You reserved it for the last, the best for the last. I mean, that was really wonderful. So, sir, before we proceed further, Ramkumar, sir, your comments.
It's not finished. No, sir.
It's not over.
We'll go to the interaction sessions.
No, you have not finished.
The presentation is not over.
Presentation is over or not over?
Over.
Okay. We declared.
Okay.
Yeah. Over's declared. Ramkumar sir, we'll go to the question answer later on within a couple of minutes. Yes, sir.
Till 5 minutes ago, I was having musha throughout. Confusion. Now musha has got vanished. Now everything clear.
Thanks to the calculator.
Excellent presentation, Mr. Kausar. You've done a good job. You've done full justice to the subject. Not only this inheritance, but also the other subjects. Everything. Wonderful.
Thank you, sir. Good presentation. Before we go to Babu sir, Ramushan sir.
It's a good presentation because a person coming from Malabar area always used to find it difficult to calculate this share and other thing. Because we've got a lot of Muslim clients and Muslim partition cases, and especially in as far as the North Malabar is concerned, you are following the Marmagathayam also. So again, once the death happens, thereafter how the Shariat will come, not per capita, but thereafter Shariat will come. So again, you will be having some more confusion as to how this will be calculated.
Yes.
So that will be. Usman Guti lawyer, there was one lawyer was there. We used to call him as a Musaliar lawyer. So he will be helpful for us in calculating the share and other thing. And whenever some doubt arises, and also Justice Namburipar, who is a senior for me also, and also my senior, he is also supposed to be one of the person who knows Muslim law well. So we used to depend on them for all help.
And sir, your senior also is good at
Ramdas Muslim was Ramdas. As a junior of Namburipar, he started his practice in under Namburipar. And thereafter, because when I joined Ramdas said, no, you'll have to go to Namburipar first. When I go to Namburipar, he said, no, you go to Ramdas because I know that you will be joining his office only. I said,
he also is good at Muslim law. He is also good at Muslim law
because he has got a lot of Muslim clients. And he was dealing with the Muslim Marmagathayam, all those things. So he is very, very prominent on those fields. So ultimately, I sat for some days with Namburipar and these two people, and both will be sharing the same case where they are appearing on either side, on the hope that I will not disclose any trade secret. That was how I was trained with by these two people. I know it's a good presentation and it's a good eye-opener on Muslim property law as such. Now, one thing I want to know, because as far as the Muslim law is concerned,
And there is no, I think that the, as far as the gift to unborn person is not recognized. But as far as Marimakathayam is concerned, that is exempted because in, I think Kerala, you can have a gift for a joint family. That is a Thavadi. So that goes to the, as far as, I think that there is an exemption as far as Kerala is, the Malabar is concerned, it appears.
Even Tiyas of North Malabar are Marimakathayas.
No, yes. not that. That is Marimakathayam is different. But as far as the gift and the personal law is concerned, you cannot have a gift in favor of an unborn person. Only the person who are present, you can do it. But the, as far as the Tavadi concept is concerned, joint family concept is concerned, that you will have to give wife and born, yes. child to be born also, such a clause is there, then that will be anyway to the benefit of the Tavadi. So unborn children also will be born. Once they come, the subsequent born children also will get it.
Mother and natural... children born to him. Born to him in that.
There is a specific provision in Mapala Marimakathayam and Dress Marimakathayam. Section 34 or something. That gives a wife through the benefit of the children as well.
There is a presumption. Uttaravakasham Thavadi. Which is called in...
Uttaravakashatavadi, yes, exactly.
Uttaravakashatavadi.
And even exactly. There was some clause where it says that the females alone, but that was said to be not valid in law.
Yes.
Because only female children will inherit. That clause will go. Now, yes. Normally, some such gift also will be seen in Malabar area.
So, the Uttaravakashatavadi principle, so far as I know, is... A gift in favor of a wife alone, a wife and children will enroll to the benefit of the family if the parties are Marimakathayas.
Yes.
Sir, Ramkumar.
Yes. Correct. But born to that person, born to the Marimakathayi male. Supposing that wife has got some other children born to some other husband.
No, they won't get it.
Yes.
It's a nice presentation, Kausar.
Thank you, Ramakrishnan sir. Thank and the person who has introduced the topic, Justice Babu sir, your take on that.
I don't just say that the presentation was good. The presentation was excellent. It was indeed, you cannot just diminish the quality of presentation by just saying good presentation. It was an excellent presentation. Yeah. Excellent presentation. So the intelligence I have seen was that he could finish big three topics in 2 hours, just 2 hours. It is impossible for many of us. Three big topics, that is Muslim inheritance is a mess. Muslim inheritance is a very, very, very tough topic. Now it is now made very easy because of the last... So, which Kausar kept it a secret till now.
Yes.
Kausar, Kausar should have distributed it to us.
At least to the Judicial Academy.
Because I'm taking Muslim law in the Kerala Judicial Academy from 2010 to 2020.
My goodness.
10 years, one decade.
Still no improvement.
No improvement. It did not strike me. So this www.islamicsoftware.
Inheritance calculator.
That's wonderful. It's wonderful. If that is...
No, I think you can delete inheritance. You can delete inheritance from topic.
Sir, Babu.
Yes.
Babu sir, we can academy can develop such a software if necessary. Seriously.
So yeah.
So we can have a software of our own academy.
Academy will be trying to get patent on this software. We will give you royalty. Don't worry.
I got it. Kausar might demit his office and only concentrate on that.
So my big problem is I wrote www.islamicsoftware.org. Rest I missed.
No, sir, I'll share it with you.
The entire thing.
That is also, you'll have to give me a premium. I'll give you that.
Okay. it shall be the duty of Shyam Patman to distribute this to all the attendees today.
Definitely.
All the attendees today.
Sure. It will be done, sir.
No, because Kausar has already promised that he will be giving this to all the persons, so that it will be made easy for your calculation or the thing. You will feel inheritance Kausar, in car.
Kausar, can I make a request? Can you do in 2 or 3 minutes?
Yes.
The Shibabil Iwas and Shibaba Sharatul Iwas. Need only 3 minutes for that, because I've covered Hiba. Hibabil Iwas.
Sale, I don't know.
Hibabil Iwas is very close to sale.
That is in fact it is a sale.
It's a gift, but it is close to sale.
Iwas
means consideration. So it's a gift for consideration. Iwas means consideration. So
Hibabil Iwas means consideration.
It's very close in India,
that is considered as
in practice it is a sale, but in theory yes. it's a gift for consideration,
gift with consideration.
Yes. So if I can take 2 or 3 minutes,
irrevocable. Is it not?
It becomes a completed sale when the Iwas was paid.
Okay.
So it need not be the market price also. So a Benz car can be gifted for a consideration of 1 kg of dates.
Yes, I can explain that. One minute.
1 kg of dates. If it is the Iwas, you can gift a Benz car.
Irrespective of the value.
Value is unimportant.
Inadequacy
of the value is unimportant. And
you can continue. In the meanwhile, I'll find it out what there is.
No issues. I think Babu sir, we'll do one thing that is also covered in the questions. We'll just start off with the question answer because we are running late.
Okay.
I have it with me.
Yes. Sir, can we just get along with a couple of the questions?
Yes, sure.
Okay, one question that has come up is, I am a Muslim, not made declaration. If I made a will in the year 2020, what is the legality?
See, that's a wonderful question. May I know you?
The question is put by Bashir.
Bashir?
Yeah.
From?
He's from Calicut.
That gift is valid. For first reason,
because that depends upon the place.
First is a Marbaktai. There is a Mapala Wills Act. See, Shariat Act section. See, Muslim person. I have already said that Muslim person is made applicable to Muslims by virtue of 1937 Act. Section 2 says that in matters relating to marriage, interstate succession, gift, etc., Muslim person law shall apply. It does not take in will, but in section 3, which deals with will and adoption, specifically says that a declaration has to be made. But so far as Muslims who follow Marumakatha system of law is concerned, there is an enactment in 1928 itself, that is Mapala Wills Act, which specifically says that the Muslims who follow Marumakathayam law, so far as wills are concerned, Muslim person law will apply. So for Muslims of North Malabar, definitely, irrespective of the fact that whether declaration under Section 3 is made or not, then Muslim person law will apply. That is a valid.
Calicut is not North Malabar.
Beyond Korapura River is North
Malabar. That is the dividing line.
No, I think up to Koyilandi or whatever it will come. Beyond
because Korapura River is the boundary.
Paksha, Calicut, it is there following the Bhagatayam system.
South Malabar.
The dividing line of North Malabar is Korapura River.
But they are following Marmakatan system law, I think.
Probably it is Malabar. Malabar will apply.
I think Ramkumar sir is alluding to the decision of the Kerala High Court where it said that there is a presumption that Tiyas of North Malabar are followers of Marimakkattayam system. Specifically mentioned.
I have read a beautiful unreported judgment by Justice P.T. Ramanayar and Justice Krishnayar. They were the two great judges who rendered that decision. P.T. Ramanayar and Krishnayar. An unreported decision, first appeal, beautifully stated this, Tiyas of North Malabar are governed by Marimakkattayam system. Presumption is that, and the dividing line between South Malabar and North Malabar is Koirappuzha River.
Yeah. Actually,
that decision should have been reported.
Even now, you can brought to the notice of the academy, so that academy can do it in judicial version at least.
Visually, it died a natural death.
Yes. So, one thing can be done, sir. We will ask the KHC George
to report it. KHC George to report it. He can do it.
Yes.
Give you the complete judgment, sir. It can
Even the old decision will come as new decisions in KHC.
Let me Kerala High Court. KLT had one KHC. Kerala KUC. Kerala KUC. Unreported.
KUC.
KUC. Unreported decisions of 1985 to 90
or something like that.
Sir, okay. I believe Bashir is here. Bashir, is your question answer?
Shyam, I'll answer the question. Even if he's not a Marimakkattayi, suppose he's not a Marimakkattayi or he's from Trivandrum, let us assume. Not made in a depression. Even at that time, rules have been framed by the Kerala also. So then, which is the law that would follow? This Indian Succession Act cannot be applied. Then the customary law will follow. What is the customary law for Muslims? This is Muslim personal law, that's all.
Correct.
So even in the absence of the application of the Muslim personal law, the customary law will follow unless there is a proved customer wise in some parts. So that gift is that, that is valid. That really is perfectly valid. That is answer. Because succession can be made up. It's a statutory law. Specifically excluded Muslims by section 58.
Okay. Yes. Bashir, is it okay?
Yes, that it means Muslim law is the declaration with...
It is not required. It is not required what is this.
Okay, sir.
Nitin, you can put a question, please.
Hello.
You're audible and visible. Please put the question.
Yeah. Okay. Is it to me? Because I can't hear anything. I don't know. There's some audio problem.
You're audible.
But I'll go with my question, sir. If you can hear me, I'll go with my question.
Yes.
Sir had said that if there is a father, and he has got two sons, one is predeceased. But the predeceased son is a daughter and one son. But when the sir given the list sharers, it included the son's daughter also a legal heir. So would she get the share into that? Because she is a daughter of the predeceased son. And I heard that you said the predeceased son, if he's not alive, only it will the property entire go to the other son who is alive. That will be the uncle of this daughter of predeceased son.
Please. I understand your question. See, the exclusion of predeceased son or daughter arises only in the case where the son or daughter is alive. See, exclusion of predeceased son arises. Hello?
Yes,
yes, you're audible.
Only if there is a surviving daughter or son.
Yes, surviving daughter or son. Angineyangle exclusion. Otherwise.
At the time of death.
Yes. So, there are chances. Then, son or daughter will come.
I think Nitin's doubt arose because in the chart shown, both are shown. So, in that magic thing. That is because if it is not there, the other thing can has to be filled up. Only for that purpose that columns are given.
No, even if you fill up that, probably the share calculation will not will come there.
Correct.
Yes. If the others are available.
Yes.
That will be excluded.
Go to Islamic calculator.
that chart takes in sharers, residuary, everyone.
Correct, correct.
Yes. Sir, one more thing I had a doubt. Sir. Just a minute. I'm sorry, sir.
Yes.
Sir, in case of will, there is a 1/3 limit. So in case of gift, so there is no any such limit. So he can give the entire property by a gift. Am I right?
Absolutely no limit. Absolutely no limit. You can.
That is how Muslims used to defeat the personal law of
The theory is that you can dispose of all your properties during your life, but you cannot dictate your succession.
That is the basic rule.
You cannot dictate your succession, but there are certain exemptions also, as Kausar said. There's a legal third rule.
And consent also.
And sir, the one side.
Consent is no problem, sir, because consent should come after the death of the testator, and the consent will never come. Consent will never come, I'm sure.
Babu, one question. Suppose some of the people consent, some of them are not.
The person who consents will be bound by that.
I don't know. I want to know whether the will be applicable, including their share to them also sometimes. Okay,
so
that's all.
If the will was not executed, the legitimate share to that, the consenting heir,
will go to the legatee.
That will go to the legatee, like how, sir?
Yes, exactly.
It is a disinherited person.
Yes, so because the right of waiver is given to the heir, I would say the heritable heir, who is entitled to inherit, heritable heir.
Right of waiver
is given to him. Le, Kausar?
But?
Le, Kausar?
Heir is heritable heir only.
The right to waive is given to him only. Yes. He has the right to waive. His share.
Who has been disinherited by the will deed?
Yes, exactly. If there are four heirs and if two consents and their share should go to the legatee.
Right.
One more question on this, because as far as the Muslim is concerned, gift as well as will can be made oral.
Yes.
How can it be proved? Whether it seems to be declared in front of somebody else or any witness or something like that?
Declaration has to be proved.
Kausar said that, sir, there must be a declaration. In the case of will, there must be a declaration.
So declaration is not that. Declaration also, I am going to relinquish my right. It can be in the presence of the person who is going to get it also, he can say, I accepted it.
Yes,
what is required is declaration that I am going to gift and acceptance by that person. Is it necessary that should be done in the presence of witnesses to prove that such a thing has happened?
It should be
in the presence and hearing of the witnesses. Witnesses should hear it.
It has to be proved in a court of law.
Yes.
Exactly.
Yes.
Like talak declaration also in the presence of the witness.
Talak also same. Okay. Marriage also same.
Hibabuli was
you may take 2 minutes or 3 minutes to say something on Hibabul Sharatul Livas because
Hibabul Livas is a gift for consideration.
Yes.
And it is in reality a sale.
Correct. In practice, it is a sale.
A judgment of the Kerala High Court, 1988, 1 KLT 409, which says that Hibabul Livas in India is not a gift, but is a transaction in the nature of a sale. And if it relates to immoral property of value of rupees 100 or onwards, it can only be by a registered instrument as provided under Section 54 of the TP Act.
Yes.
So oral, nothing is there. It is a sale.
Can you just repeat that citation?
881 KLT 409.
Thank you.
881 KLT 409, Imbichi Moidian Kutti versus Pathumuni Umma. The Babu sir, other one, I don't know. What is it?
Babu? That is, Hibaba Sharatullu was, that is a gift made with a stipulation.
Onerous gift.
Conditional.
There will be a promise from me to Kausar that I will give you one kg of dates. Okay. So he will, so will you please give
Kausar will give the Benz car to you.
So if he agrees for that, so in the case of gift, the offer should, or the action should come from the person who gives, from the donor. But in the case of Sharatul Iwas, I should request Kausar to Dhoni. give his Benz car for a 1 kg of
dates.
If he is intelligent enough, he will agree for that.
Just like an exchange.
It's more or less an exchange. It's correct. It's close to an exchange. But exchange value must be same. Eh?
It is not a gift.
It is a gift for a stipulated consideration. Yes. Consideration need not be necessarily given at the time of
adequate.
It can be offered also, just like offered maha.
Offered also.
And,
yes.
And it need not be adequate also.
It need not be adequate in value. Anything. That's why I said I wanted his Benz car for 1 kg dates.
No. We got the general idea. No show.
now we know how somebody got a Benz car.
So Sam Patman is thinking that
one more question.
This guy is very greedy.
Hey, Nitin has
very nice, sir. You're giving us idea.
Our participant Nitin has got one more.
Yes, yeah, Nitin.
One Nitin, Mr. Nitin. Yeah. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Ram Kumar, sir. My question was, sir, sir has given one citation, 1982 KLT 63, and he, I do not quite understood in that way, but legacy was three deceased son. So in that case, that particular bequest lapses, or how is it? I mean, is the legacy when the will was made, he was alive, but at the time of death of a testator, it was found that son had the deceased father. So what will happen to the bequest? Lapse, or it will devolve on the legal heir of the predeceased son?
Sir, Michael, I didn't hear.
Yeah, the question is simple. The question is one second. I have made a will, and in that will, I have given it some portion to my son, one of my sons. But he predeceases me. So on my death, what that provision regarding my predeceased son, will it lapse, or will it go to his legal heirs, or what will happen to that?
No, that's a problem. That is a.
Can you please repeat?
The person who had bequeathed to a son, but he predeceases the testator.
That will not take effect.
The entire will goes on as far as that portion allocated to this predeceased son.
Rakumar, sir, there is a provision in Indian succession.
That is not applicable. If that person leaves a lineal descendant, then that part of the bequest will go to him. Suppose a bequest, if he is a Hindu or a Christian, if A bequeaths his property to B and C, his two sons, and if B dies, and the share bequeath to, or the property bequeath to B will go to B's children.
Yes.
So that is not applicable to Muslim.
Okay.
Am I right, Kausar?
I think lapses. Indian Succession Act, there is a provision. I'm not sure. To my knowledge, there is a provision.
There's a provision.
Is only in respect of, because Indian Succession Act will not be applicable to Muslims.
Yes.
That's true. But the general principle is that if the legatee dies before the death of the testator, will lapses.
Will lapses. But yes. Under the Indian Succession Act, in case the
LR,
not the testator, suppose the legatee dies. will lapse. A Muslim will lapse, but a Hindu or a Christian will may not. So if the legati leaves,
has left behind,
he will disappear.
Correct, sir. I think that answers Nitin's question, and we move on to Sina. Please put your question, Sina.
Sir, good evening, sir. My question, am I audible now, sir?
Yes.
Yes, sir. My question is, sir has said during the first session that even with an agreement, the marriage can be dissolved. So, what is the legal impact of approaching the court?
Even
with an agreement, this marriage, Muslim marriage, can be dissolved.
Yes. I'll explain.
Sir, then what is the impact of we are approaching the court, like a court of law, we are getting for the applying for the dissolution of marriage? The same effect will it be having through? If we execute the agreement, sir. So, yes, what see, if a party approaches, what we can add is either choose this or to choose that, sir.
See, I'll explain. See, the Muslim personal law recognizes both extrajudicial divorce and judicial divorce. See, extrajudicial divorce permitted is one talaq. That is the power given to husband, subject to certain restrictions. Husband who wants to pronounce talaq need not go to the court. He can do it of his own. That's not our subject. I'm not dealing with it. There should be conciliation, reason, etc., etc., etc. Anyway, he need not go to the court. The similar power of talaq that is available to male is given to female as well. That is khula. In the similar fashion, a male pronounces talaq, a female also can divorce his wife extrajudicially without approaching the court. That is called khula.
Then there
is a third category. That category is what you commonly
hello.
Some problem with the audio.
Connectivity problem.
No, there is a disturbance there.
I think there is some connectivity problem.
Voice is breaking.
Kausar is stuck now. Yes.
Yeah, some problem with your connectivity.
Now? Kula is the right of the Muslim wife to get her marriage dissolved out of court. Then there is a third category, which is called in fiqh in Sharia law and 1939 Act, where a Muslim woman. Shyam, kelka ho?
Yes, sir.
Where a Muslim woman who wants divorce can approach the court of law and get her marriage divorced on establishing certain grounds. There is a fourth category that I was referring to. I think you are also referring to that. That is Mubarak. Mubarak means it's like 13B. 13B of the Hindu
Marriage Act.
If both parties agree that their marriage can be dissolved by mutual consent, unlike Hindu Marriage Act or Special Marriage Act or even Christian Marriage Act, that's a provision.
They
need not go to the court to get their marriage dissolved by mutual consent. As per Muslim personal law, you can simply execute an agreement in the presence of two witnesses. Even stamp paper is not necessary. That is called Mubarak. You can simply execute an agreement, get it signed, that's all, everything is over.
Sir,
if you want, you can get it registered as per the latest.
Can I add one thing, Mr. Kausar?
Yes.
That is in the Khulaf, in Mubarak form of divorce, an agreement must be executed. So the thing is that in Mubarak form of divorce, there is mutual aversion. Husband has aversion to wife. Wife has abortion to husband. So as yes. he said, just like 13B,
both of them
come to an agreement and execute an agreement.
Irreparable break yes, down.
And release himself from the other or herself from the other. And
like courts.
Yes, in the Kula form of divorce, what happens is the wife has aversion towards the husband, and therefore the yes. wife offers a consideration.
Well, I remember, but Babu, I remember Mr. Kamal Pasha saying that Kula form is not applicable in India.
No, it's not correct, sir. It's not correct.
Section 2 specifically says.
So, sir, what is not available?
Section 2 of 1934 specifically says.
Sir, what is not available? There was another form of divorce called Fisk. Fisk was the wife has certain grounds for it. Suppose the wife has abortion and the husband is not agreeing for a kula. He is not amenable to come to an agreement. I want you. Suppose that is the attitude. The wife can file or the wife can approach the in ancient times, the wife could approach the Khalifa, and that was thereafter given to the authorities, the clergy. They can go to the clergy, and the clergy will hear and pass an appropriate order. If there are grounds, desertion, cruelty, etc. That is now had taken the shape of Hindu or Muslim dissolution of Muslim marriage act. So after the enactment of dissolution of Muslim marriage act, the Kula form of applicable in India, but Fisk is not applicable in India. Kula is applicable. Mubarak is also applicable.
Mubarak mutual aversion.
Then Kula aversion of the wife towards the husband, and the wife induces or the wife wants the husband to agree for a divorce on payment of a consideration.
That is it not, Mr. Shyampadman? Shyampadman, yes. Mr. Yes. Kamal Pasha and that lady. Professor
Fasil,
she also said Kula is not applicable here, is it not?
Yes. Ramkumar sir, may explain.
Yes.
Ramkumar sir. Visible.
Yes. Sir, you are not visible.
No, I remember them to have said that this is not applicable.
Even the Muslim Dissolution of Marriage Act, now otherwise recognized under Muslim law, personal law. So other methods that has been provided also can be taken as a ground for, suppose if there is no other evidence.
So she can unilaterally divorce. Wife can unilaterally divorce.
Yes.
Cannot.
Sir, I'll take, I'll explain. Kamal.
Kausar, please.
Pasha, sir, you, I'll explain. Sir, explain.
Yes.
There is a judgment by Justice V. Khalid as early as 1971.
Okay.
It says that a Muslim wife cannot divorce.
Go ahead.
A Muslim wife cannot divorce her husband.
Okay.
Divorce 1939 Act. There is a solitary decision. Okay. But that decision is not at all correct.
I see.
Because Section 2 of the Shariat Application Act, when you check Section 2, specifically mentions Kula. And yes. Kula is something that is even sanctioned in the Quran itself. There are number of other decisions as well. Even Justice Mustaq's judgment on Talaq, Nasir alias Otti Nasir, as well as Justice Arur Rashid's later decision, both the decision clearly says that Kula is recognized under Muslim law, and a Muslim female can extrajudicially divorce his husband by exercising Kula. So, if any of that Kamal Pasha sir may be relying on
that is my memory. Maybe I am wrong. I think I remember heard Kamal Pasha saying.
Somebody has confusion. Justice Khalid the decision. Many have confusion.
Okay.
This is the law.
So can I continue? So can
yes.
I continue?
Yes, Sina, please.
Sir, you said even by the execution of this agreement itself, is, as per the Mubarak, it can be dissolved. So, sir, suppose during that time, during the execution of that agreement, one case is pending before the court for dissolution of the marriage filed by the wife. So, from which date onwards the marriage will be dissolved, sir? Either from the date of execution.
The date on which you execute agreement, you just not pass that suit in a dissolution marriage suit.
So that need not
be. See, as per going by Mubarak, it is purely extrajudicial. You need not go to the court. You simply execute an agreement. Both parties should, as Babu sir said, that both parties should decide that they have decided to dissolve their marriage.
Irretrievable breakdown.
Or even record that fact and then withdraw the suit.
Yes.
That also can be possible.
It can be a term of the agreement that we will make an application for withdrawal.
Of course. That divorce petition will become purposeless and it cannot be allowed also because divorce has already taken place.
Yes.
So there cannot be a second divorce.
Infractious. Yes. Recorded closed.
Yes.
Sir, for this Mubarak, then under the 13B, certain conditions are to be complied by both parties. So whether there are any conditions to be complied under
Absolutely no. On a fine morning, you can enter into an agreement. That's all.
Mutual aversion is the basis.
that's
the basis.
Okay, like we are not having the joint accounts, like we are not having the joint property. Nothing of that is necessary.
Nothing.
Okay.
Nothing.
No alimony.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Sina. We have advocate Lena with a question. After Sina, it is Lena. Yeah, Lena, please.
Yes. Good evening, sir. Kausar, sir. I have a doubt regarding Muslim will. I think I'm audible.
Yes.
What is the scope of appointing an executor in a Muslim will? And how about probate of it?
Probate is specifically excluded as per the Indian Constitution Act itself.
Yes.
The entire chapter is not applicable. No, executor can be appointed in Muslim will. Executor can be appointed.
No issue. There is no ban for that.
No bar. Absolutely no bar.
Okay. And one more thing, if I'm permitted to ask one more question.
Yes.
Regarding the acknowledgement of death.
Yes.
Sir, could you make something more in detail about that? And will it be having that effect of acknowledgement of liability as contemplated in Limitation Act? As far as liability of victim is concerned.
See, I was referring to acknowledgement of death done during the...
She was asking acknowledgement of deathbed.
Yes. The question is related to acknowledgement of death done during deathbed or no? Question.
Yes, like however it is being made as far as a Muslim is concerned, as per Muslim law,
acknowledgement of debt, it applies to Muslims, Christians, any other religion alike, because acknowledgement of debt is something not comes under the purview of Muslim personal law. But acknowledgement of debt that is made at the deathbed is specifically dealt in the Muslim law, which says acknowledgement of debt in favor of heir will not take place, but acknowledgement of debt in favor of a non-heir, the debt has to be proved otherwise than of the acknowledgement of debt, then it will take place. That is the difference. I think.
And there the term heir is, there the term heir is not akin to the Quranic heir, right? Legal heir.
Not at all. Quranic heir, that is called sharer.
Only for succession.
Every hair is legal also. It's wrong to say legal hair because an illegal hair is yet to be born.
Hair apparent.
Illegal hair is yet to be born. Illegal hair is not so far born in the earth. So the legal is it's
illegitimate
heir. Because you say heirship certificate, it's not a legal heirship certificate.
Correct. Yes. I think we have got Bashir has got one more question. Bashir, can you unmute and put the question? Unmute yourself.
I'm audible, sir.
Very much, please.
The very same question I asked you, sir, in the during 4 years back during the when you are taking a class at the Calicut Bar Association Hall. You might remember.
same answer or a different answer?
He wants a different answer.
He has become wiser.
Was following cows are like a shadow.
Sir, it's a scenario. Let me explain the scenario. A is the partner, and who is having two, and a? That B and C. A is the father. Who is having two sons? That is B and C.
Yes.
B is having female heirs, that is daughters and wife only. A and B died in an accident at a time unknown, their time, like day before last week it has happened, a plane, aeroplane crash, and we don't know
who died first.
And my question, sir, how the doctrine of representation is applicable in the above case? And my second, another sub-question in that question, if a father is dead, both sons are entitled for the equal shares. And if B died first, C will get the entire property of A, and also entitled for from the property of B through his father, that is A. And the second question, Is there any presumption on such death in Islamic law?
இது இஸ்லாமிக் கால்குலேட்டர்ல உண்டாவுல
இல்ல இல்ல இது 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 கால்குலேட்டருக்கே போயிட்டு காரியilla
இல்ல சரி ஆദ്യം ஹேர் ஆறானே தீர்மானிக்கணும் அது കഴിഞ്ഞിട്ടே கால்குலேட்டர்ல வருதுள்ள
if I can simplify that question, the issue is revolving only one factor, that is who died first. If it is indeterminable, what will happen? Because
Shyam, that purely depends on evidence.
Correct.
Okay.
It depends on evidence, facts of the case, who died first, that has to be decided, and Muslim law has to be applied. If there is evidence to show that these predecessors, you'll not get in it.
Is there any presumption of the elder dying first or anything like that?
No, I think there is a presumption always that the aged will die first.
The normal presumption that the elder died first is not applicable to Muslim. There is one decision. I'm unable to place my finger on it right now. Sham, I will see. I will send it to you.
Okay.
That decision holds that under the Muslim law, there is no presumption that the elder died first. If there is no evidence to find who died first, the presumption is that they died simultaneously.
Yeah.
There's one decision. I'm unable to place my finger on it right now.
That ought to be the principle.
Yes. If there is no evidence, but normal presumption here that the elder died first, is it not, sir?
Yes. I think that is some decision of the.
Yes. Yes.
That aspect.
That decision holds that presumption that the elder died first is not applicable to a Muslim. Under the Muslim law, it should be, if there is no evidence as to who died first, it should be taken that they died simultaneously. That is the problem.
Yes.
And there is one decision. I will try my level best to search it out. And if I get it, I will send it to Sham Batman.
Okay.
Now, if it is simultaneously death means, then also confusion. How it will
yes,
go?
Yes, I mean, then Babu sir, the problem is that if A dies, one set of persons will take. If B dies first, another set. If simultaneously, then who will take?
That problem was considered. I'm not in a position to tell you
now.
Yes, sir. I will search it out. And in case of hands up, I will let you know that also.
No issues.
If I don't get the decision, I will let you know.
Yes, sir.
Some Dr. Chandrasekhar Rao.
Decision, sir, Ramkumar sir may be remembering it. We have during one of the district level trainings, we have considered it.
My memory is failing.
And the presumption is of simultaneous death.
Probably your old notes will help.
Everything is there. Everything is in the computer, sir, in the academy.
Sir, today we have Professor Dr. Yes. Chandrasekhar. He teaches Muslim law. I mean, teaching Muslim law in...
Mr. Bashir.
Yes, sir. Bashir, unmute yourself. I think I tried to unmute Professor Chandrasekhar. If he can also join the discussion, it will be wonderful. Yeah.
We saw his message. No.
Yes, yes. I am trying to unmute. He can unmute himself. Yeah. Yeah, Kausar, please.
Bashir, give me your phone number. I'll study it and let you know.
Yeah, definitely.
I'm associated to Shambatman, sir.
Shambatman.
He is with our Calicut office and he's also doing independent work also.
That was an indirect attack.
He's sitting at Calicut.
Yes.
It's in his catchment area.
Yes.
We have Dr. Chandrasekhar. Can you, sir, please join us on this issue?
Yes, sir. Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
This is my second collaboration with you people.
Appearance.
Hello.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Yes. Appearance will be a little bit dangerous.
No problem.
because now you can see.
Yes.
So this is my second meeting with you people.
Yes.
I'm very glad to be amidst you people. And for the last 10 years, I'm teaching Muslim law as well as Hindu law for KSLU syllabus.
Okay.
Unfortunately, I saw the advertisement, that message is now only, just 10 minutes back.
No issues. We'll forward you the recorded please, presentation of Dr. Kausar as well as all the discussions that has transpired today, sir. We will.
Because while teaching Muslim law, I am getting very, very much influenced by the codes as well as the thought of Quran and other things. And I will imbibe and impart the same thing to the student. And even students are also behind me in the classroom and other things. And it's okay. Well, teaching is very easy. But in respect of that part, where the partition, succession, inheritance, that gives me even to me also very, 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 very difficult this one. Because it is a full of that calculation which we could not able to cope up. Whereas in Hindu law, it is very easy. The sweet cake, we can go on, part it and give to all the members alive. But here it is little bit...
Today he came with the formula because there is a website.
Dr. Kausar has cut the Gordian knot today. The inheritance.
And I will be very fortunate if I will get the link and recorded this one.
Definitely.
And I will follow that. You are going very sincerely.
The link is already posted in the chat. Sir, the link is already posted in the chat. I'll repost it again because you had joint only date. You might not get it. So I'm just reposting it. Sir, use the link and join so that everything that is shared in the group, you will get, sir.
For that, I will be very, very, very sincere and obedient to you people.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Thank you, sir. And
very grateful
for the questions.
Yes, sir.
I already posted, sir.
Thank you.
Can I just read out the other questions so that we can, we are already reaching 6:30. One another question that has come up, based on the Mubarak's agreement, the parties are entitled to get decree also based on the said agreement. Is it so?
Not necessary. Not at all necessary, because that is the conclusive. There ends the marriage. Why again a decree? Why you want a decree?
Okay.
That is a solid proof that your divorce, your marriage is dissolved as per the Muslim postal law applicable to Muslims in India. Then why a seal of the court is necessary?
Kausar, you will not get a decree in the case of a talaq.
No.
You will not get a decree. No decree is needed. You will not get a decree in the case of a talaq. Talaq Hasan and talaq Hasan. Talaq in that alone is now forbidden.
Yes, sir.
Same as the case here.
Yes, sir, we have Advocate Harish from Bangalore. Harish, sir. Yeah, you're already unmuted. You can speak.
Yeah. Good evening, Mr. Shyam. Good evening, Kausar, sir. Thank you very much for an excellent
enlightening session. I just came in a little later, but when you were just about to start on succession and things like that before the Islamic calculator, it has been made our job simple here. I have been doing webinars on will and things like that, on lapse of legacy and things in the Mohammedan law and things. This simultaneous death issue which was told. If we get the citation, Ashen, we will be very grateful to you, because I have always been telling that depending on who died first, as the legacy may lapse. If the legacy dies first, then the legacy will lapse and it will revert back to the testator. That's what is my understanding on.
We'll wait for the feedback from Babu sir. Once it is received, I'll definitely share in the platform as well as in the WhatsApp group.
I've shared the email ID also. We'll let you know. I would like to participate in other things also.
That is already posted in the chat, sir. You can just use the link. That's already posted in the chat. Another question that has come up. We'll just rush through the questions. Whether children get any birthright in the property?
I've forgone my Indian Succession Act webinar to listen to you all, which is going on now in Advocates in Bangalore.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Hari sir.
Thank you.
Another question that has come up is: children get any birthright in the property?
No.
Then another question is: how is the role of nominee on a financial instrument regarded in the context of estate of a deceased?
That is general principles for nominees.
Okay.
What is the status of a nominee? You can accept it, distribute to the actual person for entity. That's all. He's a trustee.
In the answer,
the nominee it is amenable to all rightful claims.
Yes, it's only custodian.
He can only receive.
Yes, it's only custodian.
One more question we'll take before we wind up. That is from Dr. Sanjay Dange. If Muslim woman wishes to bequeath her property to her only son, can she make a will to that effect?
Yes, that is valid, perfectly valid, because if there is no other heir, if sole heir, you can bequeath the entire property.
Okay. I think there are a couple of questions more, but we'll request them. So we'll take those questions and forward it to Kausar. And once the answers are received, we'll post. Yeah.
Sam, there is an interesting question there. Yeah. What is the fate of the innocent purchaser in preemption case?
Correct. That is, we'll take that question also. There is a question that is, like you said, preemption right is to be exercised after the sale occurs. So what happens to the person, like the usual terminology, bona fide purchaser for consideration without notice of all this preemption, etc.?
You will have to be compensated.
He will get the price. There is one decision holding that. Bona fide purchaser. One decision holding that when preemptor wins, then what happens is there is a virtual rubbing of the name of the real purchaser from the title deed and inserting his name. So he will get the price. He will get the price back.
Yes.
Okay, sir.
For preemption, immediately after the sale, he has to make the declaration. After the sale, he has to make the declaration. That declaration has to go to the purchaser.
And the limitation 1 year starts from that declaration.
Affirmation.
Limitation starts from the
date of sale.
That is his cause of action.
Then he has
We'll take a last question from Advocate A.S. Dilip, sir. Dilip, sir, go ahead, please.
Good evening, sir. Thank you so much for the enlightening presentation. Sir, you mentioned that two kinds of preemption, namely those exercisable by one, the neighbor, and the two, owner of the dominant heritage of a particular property, which was sold, were struck down as they violated Article 19(1)(f) of the Constitution as it stood then as a fundamental right by the apex court. But in 1978, the right to property was deleted from Part 3 of the Constitution. My question is whether by this deletion of right to property from the hold of fundamental rights, have the said decision ceased to be the law on subject? And also whether the two preemptions previously struck down and declared violative of fundamental right would resume their validity and enforceability by the operation and doctrine of eclipse, though this principle applies primarily to repeal of statute or an amendment act or amended provisions and not only and note the precedents. That's my
question. Do that decisions are based on Article 19(1)(f) alone?
Yes. So what is the legality and enforceability of those preemptory rights?
Right. Good question. Good question. Dilip, good question.
That is.
Yes.
Can you undone a thing which has already been undone by the precedent earlier? Hmm.
That is his question. Can you exercise the preemption with respect to the, I mean, participation, windage, etc. at present? That is the question, isn't it?
Yes.
I think that decision may not apply now, because that was entirely based on Article 19(1) of which is not in the statute at present.
300A.
Yes, 300A. Now it's a constitutional right, not a fundamental right.
Yes.
It's a legal right.
It's a legal right. Legal. Like illegal has, there is no illegal right.
Yes.
There are imperfect rights.
Imperfect rights. Inchoate.
In not any inchoate right.
Quite a lot. I don't
need to go there. No. I was just on the lighter way in talking to Dilip, sir.
So shall we conclude?
Yes.
So what we'll do is that, sir, like Ramkumar sir suggested, all the remaining questions we'll articulate and send it across to the faculty of the day, and we'll post the answers in the our groups. So, Prem, over to you.
Well, it was a good see, let me just ask you one thing, because we were on this 37 Act, which of course by say the personal law it is applicable, as during the initial stage itself you had told that it is by virtue of Article 225 as well as some of the statutes which were passed by the Imperial Parliament. Now let me just ask you, because you were on that Narasimha Pass case of 1952 at an earlier part. So the issue goes that long prior to 1951 itself, because at that point, that was at that point of time the Bombay High Court judgment comes in that Narasimha Pass case. Subsequently, you can see there were so many judgments. Several judges of the High Court had posed this particular thing for reconsideration. And we have the 1980 judgment of the Supreme Court. I think it was in Sri Krishna Singh versus Mathura Ahira, think so, because I'm not sure.
Yes.
Anyway.
Yes.
This was turned down in 1997 by the idol of Swaminathan Swami, the Tirukoyil judgment.
Yes.
And subsequently again comes another judgment during 1997 itself. It's the Ahmedabad Women's Action Group's case. And see, right now we have the Shairo Banu judgment in front of us. Shairo Banu, if you see, the two dissenting judges, that is one is Justice Kehra and the other is Justice Nazir, you can see they make their dissents in diametrically opposite approaches. Because Justice Kehar, on the ground of constitutionality, Justice Kehar's opinion, to which of course Justice Nazir joins, he takes a different view. One takes a position that the Muslim personal law, on which the state has enacted a law, that is 1939 law, as well as the 1986, you have the Muslim Women's Protection of Rights on Divorce Act of 1986, it can be tested for compliance with the fundamental rights. One says so, the other says no, I'm not going to test it on the basis of under part 3 of the constitution. Now, whether it is law in force, as has been said in Article 13 of the constitution, even the minority does not control. Now, kindly see the majority judgment. We have one judgment of Justice Kurian Joseph, and the other is the judgment of Justice Nariman, with whom Justice Lalit concurs. You can see, even in Justice Nariman's opinion, to which Justice Lalit has been a concurring, that again goes in another opposite direction with that of Justice Kurian Joseph. See, Justice Nariman would clearly say that he takes a view that the function which was performed by the Act of 1937, it was not to merely abrogate the application of the customary law, which was applicable to Muslims. It performed a positive function. As far as Justice Nariman says, he says it performed a positive function and it provided that what was the applicable law. See, the entity which you call the Muslim personal law, according to this particular view, it was brought into existence by the state in the exercise of its civil authority, which of course finds place in the what you call the laws in force of Article 13. But finally, when concluding, Justice Nariman, he would go on to say that the 37 Act itself, that is in conflict or it is in opposition with Article 13. Even though towards the last paragraph, he would say that we do off with Section 2 to the extent what we have decided earlier, to the extent what we have discussed earlier. That was the concluding part. But kindly see the entire part, if you read the entire part, what Justice Nariman says is the 37th Act itself, that is against the spirit of Article 13. Then can you say that the Application Act of Section 37 is in force?
I'll answer. The decision you referred, that is Bombay Narasu Appamali Krishna Singh and Masalamai Mudaliar versus Idol, and also Allahabad Women's Association case. All those decisions were
Ahmedabad.
Yes. All those decisions considered the question whether laws in force, personal law, are laws in force or not. That was the consideration. And in all those decisions, it was held that law, personal law, will not come within the purview of laws in force. And subsequently, in other two decisions, Masalamani Mudaliar and Chandram, it was held that laws in force, personal laws would come within the ambit of the definition laws in force and then amenable to Article 13 of the Constitution. So there is view on one side and on the view on the other side. But you were referring to Sharabanu. See, Sharabanu did not consider the issue whether personal law is a laws in force or not at all. The Sharabanu only considered the issue whether the personal law of Muslim is a state action or an uncodified law in view of Section 9 of 1937 Act.
Let me just clarify. See, it's the other way around. See, in the dissenting opinion, they were about to go on to say whether it is law in force or not. But Justice Kehar would say that we have seen whether it's a law in force or not. It has been decided by strength of a co-equal bench, which was perfectly wrong because it was all two.
I think you are confused. See, the personal law did not, the sanctity of the personal law or the sanctity of the triple talaq in the personal law was not examined on the touchstone of the question of law is law in force in Sharabanu. On the other hand, what was considered in Sharabanu was whether the uncodified personal law of the Muslims which deal with triple talaq is a statutory law in view of 1937 Act or not. That was the consideration. And the majority judgment has held that all forms of talaq, not the majority judgment, only Lalit and Justice Nariman, Kurian Joseph did not agree. Took the view that all forms of talaq recognized and enforced by Muslim personal law are recognized and enforced by 1937 Act. Hence, it is a state action. Thus, it comes within the purview of law, not law in force, then amenable to constitution. Whereas the Justice Kahar judgment is that Shariata did not legislate in the field of personal law. So, it is only a law in force, not the law. That is the basic difference. So, Sharabanu did not answer that issue. Narasu Appamali's dictum has not been examined in Sharabanu. You read it carefully.
Absolutely true. You can read the dissenting judgment. Justice Kehar goes on to say, why I do not propose to examine it in view of Article 13 is why? Because there are judgments by judges of, bitches of equal strength, which we are trying, which is patently wrong. Because you had the three judgments, which were on two judge benches. But
they could have considered.
No, no, it is not like that. That is why it was not considered. Because Justice Nariman and Justice Kurian Joseph, who wrote the majority judgment, separate majority judgment, they went the other way around. They did not consider this particular thing.
Yes, yes.
But again, Justice Nariman would go on to say, against Article, it is against Article.
Kurian Joseph,
he says so about the Quranic thing.
Yes.
Totally different angle. Exactly, it's not even a majority judgment. You cannot even call it a majority judgment. Because even though there is three reasons, two factors, yeah, majority and all.
Ray, though different reasons were given, end of the day, they concurred to one point. Whether this
so can Trivandalagi is not constitutional, that's all.
Shyam Padman, we will agree to disagree, that's all.
Definitely.
Agree to disagree.
Yes.
The beauty of this platform is that, sir, we throw up and deliberation. It's not, we are not here to find answers.
No, this is an
answers will discuss issues.
No, not that.
Prem has got always got an inclination to kindle the thoughts.
No, that is descending. Descending as the purpose of this platform.
Kindling the thought alone, because
no, I'm not saying kindling the thought. On a
carefully, if you read the judgment very carefully, you can see.
Yes.
I'm complimenting you, Prem.
Yes. This time.
No, every time I used to compliment in that way only.
Because I am fortified by the reasoning of what you see in the judgment itself. Kindly see Justice Nariman's judgment. He would say it goes against Article 13. Patently he says. But at the subsequent portion, he says, to the extent Section 2 violates.
You're right.
Absolutely. I mean, we started off by saying that prospective overruling, is it a majority judgment? That, of course, it kindled thought because everybody took it like that. But once we see the decision, we'll see that it's not a majority. It's only few among others differed, three differed. So likewise, we'll keep these things open because let us have deliberations. It's already 6:45 and our brains are getting lagged a bit. So I think let us call it a day, but a wonderful day, wonderful session. Dr. Kausar Edappagath, I don't know how this platform, and thank you for initiating and also introducing the subject so beautifully, and for that final magical presentation of making everything so simple. But the build-up was really good so that we could understand the basis, we could understand the nuances, and finally when you offered the final, formula, it was really wonderful. And thank you, Justice Babu sir, for introducing the topic and being with us today throughout, and also for agreeing to address us on 30th on another facet of Muslim law, which is marriage and divorce, of course. And Ram Kumar sir and Ram Krishna sir, for your valuable inputs and presence, and all of you, wonderful participants, on this 74th Independence Day. It comes to when we come to the end of the 106th session tomorrow, we have Justice Basant. He'll be dealing with a very, very interesting topic, an ideal death penalty law for India. Let us have deliberations, debates, etc. tomorrow at 3:30. Till then, keep on deliberating, keep on debating, but do stay safe and take care. Thank you.
Thank you.